Hello, everyone. Welcome to X-Plane 11. I'm Martin Wenzel. Today we're going to be flying from Palau International Airport. It's got a longer name, but I'm going to go with that, to Guam International Airport. So we're going to be going from Palau to Guam. Right now, getting the airplane set up. I just turned off the disconnected the ground power just to make sure it's connected. Switch that the selection to ground power. Turn off the master switch. We got to put on the emergency lights, fasten seatbelt signs, and all right. I'm using SimBuddy. You can't see it here on the recording. But it's a little app here that lets me do load passengers like I'm actually flying and serve them drinks and all that stuff. So that'll be going on. You'll hear that in the background. All right, so we're gonna put our fuel on here, our payload, and this is all in pounds. I want this in kilograms just because SimBrief puts everything in kilograms. But I'm getting the amount of passengers and cargo, getting that from SimBuddy, doing a virtual airline. And then I get the fuel from SimBrief right here. We have to put on 8,449 kilograms is what they're saying for fuel. And that's because we need some extra fuel to get to Saipan as our alternate. And it looks like it has some extra reserve fuel. We turn on the packs, align the nav, and we're going to put everything into the FMS. Let's get this panel lit up so we can see the keys and everything. Downloaded a mod that lets me actually type into the FMS so I don't have to hit all the buttons. So we put in our initial reference, the airport we're at. We're at PTRO. And then we're going to copy the location right there. Then we're going to go to the route. We put in our origin, PTRO. And then our destination is going to be PGUM, P-G-U-M, for Guam. And we'll bring up the route that I have saved, and we are United 192. We got, I think, a reserve of one. Actually, yeah, the reserve is about one. And then put in our cruising altitude of 35,000 feet.
Captain, all passengers are on board.
Okay, so that's SimBuddy there telling us all the passengers are aboard, and we're gonna start some music and do the pre-flight announcements pretty soon. Just flipped on the APU. Get that spooling up so we can disconnect from the ground power. Get the packs going, cycle some air in here. Get some air conditioning going because it looks like it's pretty warm outside.
On this flight, we offer personal device entertainment.
All right, we're going to set the cabin altitude. This is for the pressure. And if we set that at the wrong time, we'll have some trouble. Go outside, look at the plane. Flying the United livery, the new one they just released. Flying in Zeebo's 738, Boeing 738 mod for X-Plane. All right, so we'll get the APU going here. Got the APU bleed on, switch it, put the APU gen there, and we'll disconnect and we'll get rid of the chocks as well. And now we can actually call up. There we go. We'll put in our flight plan. We'll see if this works. Been having some trouble with this on some of these islands out here in the Pacific. Just recently, since I started using SimBuddy, been having some trouble with it. Where I'll put all this information in and then it won't get back to me and let me file the plan at all. Not the end of the world. And it looks like it's not going to give us anything. So we can still get the altitude.
Altimeter 2972.
We'll put that in. 29.72 inches. That's for the pressure.
Bronze gazebo, altimeter 2972, United 192.
So I jumped over here. I'm also using World Traffic 3, which puts our real air traffic in the sky so you can see it. And so you can actually use the ATC with them, and that will actually work with the aircraft that's flying around, so you're not actually going the opposite direction on the runway.
Doors to automatic on cross-check.
Flight attendants, please be seated for departure.
All right, so we're going to have the flight attendants get the doors set up. We're going to get the fuel pumps going. Get all of them left, center, and right, and get the electrical. And now we can... Oh, got some music going there. A little bit of Paul McCartney and Wings. Hopefully YouTube doesn't crack down on that for this episode. This was mostly a test. I wasn't planning on making a video of this.
Ground to cockpit.
Our pushback. Very small airport, only three gates. And we'll just do a little 90-degree pushback. Get on the
ground to cockpit. Tail is driving up.
Using another program right here up in the left corner, this little macro will adjust the graphic settings for the game depending on how much is going on, so that you can keep a good frame rate around 30 frames per second. So sometimes the graphics will actually downgrade a little bit. Haven't seen it, it's not too noticeable though, so it's been working out well. Maybe that's the reason I'm able to make this video. Because before I tried to do it and the program OBS just crashed, it wouldn't even be able to record and play X-Plane at the same time. Alright, so we're waiting for the pushback. Alright, there we got our computers are all up. That means the nav, the IRS is all lined
okay.
up and ready to
all
go.
All doors and hatches are closed. Ready to connect.
Alright, I just started doing the pre-flight announcement, but basically our passengers should have all their stuff and should be in their seats by now. So I'm trying to figure out how I can be able to show you that little box from SimBuddy. I'm not sure why it's not showing up. And we'll turn this panel on, so because we're doing a night flight, I believe it's 3 in the morning. Yep, 3:14 a.m. Should be arriving at Guam about 6 in the morning, so the sun will be rising. And she has said we can release the parking brake, get pushed back, and we'll be able to start our engines.
Starting pushback, and you may start engines.
Flight attendants, seats for takeoff.
All right, so I just told the flight attendants, I've told the passengers and the flight attendants to all buckle their seatbelts, just because SimBuddy's very sensitive and has an issue with pushbacks. They'll fall over, people will fall over with the pushback and get injured. So I flipped off the packs and have now set the engine to the left engine to ground or GRD. I'm not sure what the GRD means exactly, but that's getting it started. We want to get over 20. On the little panel over there, and then we pull up to idle that little knob. You'll see it here when we do it with the right engine, GRD. And then when we get to 20 on the middle panel there, we'll pull this guy up and get the engines spooling at full strength. And then when that flips to there, we'll flip it to continuous, get the generators on, and switch to Gen 1, flip off the APU, and the APU bleed, and then put back on our packs. If we forget to do the packs, then we'll get the probe there, yaw damper on. If we forget to put the packs back on, we'll get up to 35,000 feet, our cruising altitude, and we'll start blacking out because the
operation
cabin
complete.
Pressure will be
Go
all
ahead
messed
and
up.
Set the parking brake.
And you don't want that. Set the parking brake and they're going to release
Stand by.
Disconnect.
flight attendants. Prepare the cabin for takeoff.
Alright, so I had them sit down and get seatbelted, and they hadn't actually prepared the cabin yet. So they're going to get up and do that. Just put the flaps to 5, setting 5 degrees. And put the auto brake to RTO, I think that's what it is. And that's for takeoff. See the pushback vehicle disconnecting.
Tow is disconnected and bypass pin has been removed. Hand signal on the right. We'll see you next time and have a safe flight.
Thank you very much. Alright, once they get over there, they're going to give us a hand signal.
The cabin is secure.
Alright, cabin secure, so we'll have the flight attendants, get buckled back up. We'll turn on our runway, turn off lights, taxi lights. Everything else is set to go. We got all our other lights for taxiing set. And all we got to do is just kind of look to the right. See the hand signal. Alright, we'll release the parking brake, give the throttle a little bit. And while we're taxiing, we're just going to be taxiing right here to runway 9. And as we taxi, we should be arming the auto throttle, two flight directors, making sure everything's set up for the autopilot. I think I'm going to do that right when we get to the stop point. The holding point. So we're holding at runway 9. This is actually where we landed. We came in on 27. So we're going to put on our landing lights. Position steady, strobe and steady. Get the TCAS. Parking brake on. We'll set all of our autopilot, VNAV and LNAV, so that when we hit the autopilot on, once we take off, it will get us right on our course, and then we can sit back and monitor the situation. It's about a 3-hour flight, if I'm not mistaken. Let me see. 2-hour flight, 2-hour estimated flight time, that's the estimate. We'll see. Should be able to do it. Usually we do it quicker. Usually shave 10-15 minutes off these flights. Get into position. When we get to bigger airports, and that's the thing, what I'm doing right now is I'm doing a world tour. Started in New Zealand. Unfortunately, didn't start recording videos for it because I didn't think I could. So maybe at the tail end of this world tour, we'll go through some of the countries we already passed through. But I'm trying to get into every country and territory in the world. We're just going to go around with this 737-800, switch the livery up to real liveries as we go. And here we go. We got to the Toga. The throttle of the Toga and release the parking brake, and we're gonna take off, ready to go. So when we get to 80, we're gonna push the joystick down, try to keep the nose down. And then when we get to our V2 speed of 151, we're gonna pull back and take off.
V1, rotate.
We're gonna rotate. There we go.
Positive rate.
And when we get to over 400, we can set the autopilot, and we'll jump outside and take a picture. Get to see all the night lights on Palau. Bring up the landing gear. as I was saying, we're flying to, trying to fly into every country and territory in the world. Started in New Zealand, gone to, done most of the South Pacific, and now we're going to be headed up to Guam here, then Saipan, the Northern Mariana Islands, and then over to the Philippines, and we're going to start going New Guinea, Papua New Guinea, and up through Malaysia, Indonesia, Malaysia, and then into Indochina. And from there, get into Taiwan, Japan, China, Mongolia, and then figure out where to go to get through the Middle East. Then probably go down into Africa, go through Africa, and then come back up and go through Europe. And then cross over the Atlantic and do Canada, North America, go on down into South America, and then come back and go out to Hawaii, and we'll do the whole South Pacific again, and hopefully I'll be able to make videos for all those flights, and you'll enjoy those. Just looking around different views, here we got the co-pilot view. Now we jump right back to the pilot. We are climbing nicely. Now that I know I can make these videos, I'm going to be trying to make videos for all the flights, and I've had some requests from guys in my iRacing league who have also dabbled in X-Plane. And I'll try to make a startup video for the 738-800, the 737-800, Boeing 737-800, how I started up. It might not be exactly the way you're supposed to. I'll link to a great channel where it's an actual pilot of a 737 doing the startup procedures. He does everything. That's where I've learned so much. Having a good week this week doing landings after a really awful week in Australia. All right, so we just ran out of fuel in the center tank. We only had, I think, 500 or 600 kilograms in there, and usually you'd turn it off at that point. So here we can see the wind, the clouds, solid cloud cover, but it's also night, so we're not going to see much. We're going over the Pacific. I don't think we're going to be going over any land masses between here and Guam. This clock on the left side of the pilot side is set to Zulu time, or Zulu. That's a universal, universal time. And then on the other, the co-pilot seat, it actually shows us the local time, and it's 3 in the morning. Okay, so you can see I'm clicking at the SimBuddy, but it's not showing up in the recording. And that's because SimBuddy, actually, to use SimBuddy, because X-Plane is usually a full-screen program, to use X-Buddy, you need to, a good way to do it is to get a borderless gaming, which allows you to play X-Plane not full-screen, but it is full-screen and borderless, so that SimBuddy can lay on top of it. I haven't figured out, though, how to record my whole display. It should still show that, because I am recording my display, so you would think it would show SimBuddy overlaid here, but there's little options. I can tell the crew to unbuckle their seatbelts. I told them to get up and resume service. You can tell the passengers that they can now move around the cabin, use the restroom, and that's SimBuddy. Actually, if you don't release the seatbelts, let the passengers roam around, they will start complaining that they need to use the restroom and they want to get up and get a drink or get their laptop or whatever. And then also keep track of letting the crew deliver drinks, do food service, and also turn on the in-flight entertainment. Now that's a little bit of it. I love the in-flight entertainment, and hopefully I can get it that it can show us, we can see SimBuddy in the future, because you'll see they're watching, you know, Air Crash Investigation 7 or Castaway.
Let us know if there's anything
really funny stuff.
Make your flight more comfortable.
got them starting to serve refreshments. It's a little bit difficult with the flights I've been doing because my flights are usually 3 or fewer hours. So maybe you can get a drink service, you can get that food service in, and then it'd be nice to get another drink service right before we land, but usually that food service is, we're almost on approach by the time we get the food service done. You got to get the crew then to get the cabin all ready for a landing and get them buckled in. And by the time that all happens, we're on the final approach. So some of these flights are, they go fast when you're dealing with all that stuff. But as I was saying, there's, I think it's Flight Deck to Sim. He's a great YouTube channel, great resource for learning how to fly these sim planes using the real procedures and the real way they do it. And I've definitely learned a lot in the past week. Last week I was having a terrible time landing because I'm so used to doing the ILS, the instrument landing, using the instrument landing system to do the auto land. And I've done about 100 flights like that and struggled at the beginning, nailing the runway too hard and busting off the wheels and, you know, running on the belly and crashing like that. Finally got that down over 100 flights. It was becoming pretty automatic. But out here in the Pacific, a lot of airports do not have ILS. And so flying into Australia, I had just no luck in Australia landing. Came into the Gold Coast Airport. That one was just a hard landing with the ILS. Flying into Sydney, the autopilot just didn't seem to ever want to get settled, and then ended up nosediving right before the touchdown area. All right, so we got to turn on the heat, the window heat. Otherwise, our windows will completely fog up and ice up because the temperature is now -2 degrees Celsius and falling. We just came from, you know, probably close to 30 degrees. Check our legs of our journey. But yeah, crashed in Sydney. Then we did flight to Sydney from Sydney to Melbourne. And crashed in Melbourne, the same thing, just couldn't get the autopilot settled. Then we took a flight to Melbourne, Alice Springs. Now, I think Alice Springs did not have ILS. So now this was the first time I had to do... Okay, so right there, we just had an issue, and I've cut it out in the editing process. But SimBuddy sometimes disconnects. And so what it will do is it will then pause the game. It'll say SimBuddy has disconnected, SimBuddy has connected, and it's a little annoying that it, for some reason, just it can't stay connected all the time. So hopefully that doesn't become a big major issue, and hopefully I'm able to catch all those and just make it as seamless as possible in the edit. But with Alice Springs, I had to do an RNAV approach, which is basically, it's more... You can still fly in autopilot, but you do have to manually land it at the end. It will bring you in on the glide slope, on the right descent pattern, but then you have to take over right at the end. Probably within the last 1,000 feet is probably the best place to start, and bring it in yourself. And I didn't know how to do it. I didn't know what the RNAV was supposed to be doing, and so I crashed in Alice Springs. And then I looked into it, I learned how to do it. Our flight from Alice Springs to Brisbane was able to land that one relatively well. Then I think it was, we did a flight from Brisbane to Vanuatu. That one I think I landed okay. No, that one I didn't land okay. That one, that was probably my worst crash of all, where it was like 14,000 feet per minute dive into the ground. It was just an epic, destructive crash. I think I was coming in on the approach really nicely. I was feeling very good about coming in, and then I had forgotten to knock the auto throttle off, and so it jumped to the next waypoint, and then the auto throttle throttled up the plane and started taking off back to the like missed approach pattern. And so yeah, and then I didn't get the flaps retracted, and it nosedived. So But this last week's been very good. I finally got it down. I had a landing of 11 feet per minute, which is, you're greasing that one. That's amazing. Landing, another one was a 32. I've kind of gone back to about 200, which is still okay. Anything under 200, and then the G's are the more important thing. You want to be under, you know, anywhere between 1 and 2 G's. You don't want to be snapping people's necks landing. So we're going to be climbing to 35,000 feet. We're at 27,000 right now. Once we get up there, the passengers are already able to move around. You can move around before you get to cruising altitude.
Let's go.
Captain, we have started serving food.
Thank you. Alright, I'm condensing this for time. There's not a lot to see, it's like a real life flight. You're just sitting in the air. Not a ton to do always on these longer flights. But we're getting to the point where we should start thinking about our approach. Now, in real life, you're usually going to have, and if we were doing VATSIM or something, there would be ATC. The World Traffic 3 ATC and the X-Plane Air Traffic Control, they're not the best at giving you approaches. And you really should already have your approach plan usually before the top of the descent, or at least, I think, at least an idea where you're going. But ATC has not been working very well lately. So we're going to I think we're going to look down here. See, I got the departure and arrival screen. And we're going to do 6 left, ILS 6 left. We got the chart popping up on the screen right now. And it's taking me a little time because I'm looking at the chart as we're doing this. Trying to figure out which waypoint I should be going with. It looks like we have 3. And none of them, I don't think any of, I'm looking at the chart, I don't think any of them match our last leg. Because our last leg actually on our plan is Obale, or O-B-A-L-E. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to just put in, I picked the first one, see where it goes. And that looks right, actually, if we just go to Obale. So we'll just make sure that we don't have Obale twice, because it will skip both ways. So we're going to fly right into the approach. We're not going to have any circling, not going to have any real big turns. Just a very simple approach path. The runway is on 63 degrees. So here we are, going to delete the couple of those waypoints and just get directly into Obale, where we were anyway. And so the autopilot with the VNAV should take us down to, hopefully get us to that altitude on time. It should. The VNAV usually is pretty good about that, unless you change things at the last second. So we'll hit Obale, and then we will cruise in. We'll capture the glide slope at some point. That'll be a 3-degree descent angle. And then we'll have to make our decision. At some point, I'll set the minimums. And on the chart, the minimums is that MDA on the bottom, LNAV MDA category. And it says LNAV MDA. And it says 720 and a half. I'm not sure what the half is. Again, I'm not an expert on reading these charts, but I think the 720 is the MDA. And Flight Deck to Sim said that they usually, at least where he works at his airline, they add 40 feet to that so that they're not going under the minimums, just in case, because sometimes you might lose 40 feet. You don't want to go below the minimums of 720 until you are sure you're actually coming in for the landing. So we are, looks like we're set with our approach, where we're going to be coming in on runway 6 left. Now it'd either be 6 left or it would be obviously the opposite, which would be 24 right. That is going to be the longer runway of the two at Guam. And we will have an ILS landing this time. I think Guam has one, and then our next one also in Saipan will have an ILS.
Somebody is connected. appreciate you being with us today. Wish you a very safe and pleasant journey. My pleasure. Hopefully you're back here with us.
Somebody is disconnected.
Captain, we have started serving.
All right, we're getting pretty close to our final destination. We're going to be going to that left runway, the longer one, 6 left. I'm just checking the altitude or the altimeter myself. Sometimes the ATC will disappear, so we're going to adjust that. We're a little high right now, but the VNAV should correct that eventually. We'll be okay. We got to make sure our the ILS frequencies are set. Beautiful sunrise here. It's been a while since I've had a good sunrise landing. See Guam growing larger in our window.
Somebody is disconnected.
We got the flight attendants preparing the cabin for landing. All the passengers are buckled in. We have our look outside the plane. We got the course set, 64 degrees. We're going to be going down to 220 knots. And we're within 30 nautical miles, so we're going to put on our landing lights and our runway turnoff lights. That's all the lights we need. We'll put the wheel well lights on, and we'll switch to position steady once we're on the ground and taxiing. Flight Deck to Sim says that you should put the taxi light on. The taxi lights on also when you're coming in for the landing after you've gotten approval for your landing. You're actually cleared to land. But I've noticed that when I do that, SimBuddy registers that you don't have your lights on landing, and so you lose some points. SimBuddy gives you points for your landings and for your flight. And if you don't have your lights on landing, you lose 500 points. Well, I had my lights on, but I also had the taxi lights. I guess that negates it for some reason. Nice sunrise. That's really, look at that sunrise and the pink clouds. X-Plane is beautiful, and I don't even have any real graphical mods on at all. Just don't have a powerful enough computer to do that right now. We're already at flap setting 1. We have the auto brake set to 2, because the runway is a decent length, so we don't need to... You know, I think we're taking this at flaps level 30. All right, let's back the speed down a little bit. And you can see before I hit the speed interval button there, the SPDINTV button right next to the little knob. That allows us to manually control the speed instead of VNAV setting it, because as you put the flaps down, VNAV will usually drop the speed way down.
Flight attendants,
but we don't need to get that slow yet.
Somebody is connected.
Just heard SimBuddy saying it was connected. It actually disconnected for a while there. And we can turn off the window heat because the temperature is well above 10 degrees Celsius. We got a little bit of a holding pattern here. Now, I'm not sure yet. I'm gonna have to learn how to do this. I'm not sure how to enter a holding pattern. How to enter a holding pattern and actually take the pattern, because I kind of want to do it here, but I don't know how to do it. And you would think it would just go into it, but I think once we get to this waypoint, it will just skip to the next one and skip the holding. So that'll be another thing I have to learn as I'm going here. I think I had the flight attendants get seated before they'd actually finished preparing the cabin, because I think it had all frozen up a little bit. And there's Guam. The clouds clear. We can just see the airport over that ridge of mountains. I think that's it. Well, maybe not. Yeah, I think that will be. We are now lining up directly with our approach, 64 degrees. So at this point, we're gonna get to flaps 5, and now we're gonna hit the approach button, and we're gonna get both autopilots connected. And now it's going to, as soon as it captures the glide slope, it's going to fly in using the ILS system. And we could actually let it land, basically a plane could land itself. Theoretically. We do have some ortho photos of Guam that came as part of a package. Problem with ortho photos is that unless you have someone go puts together a package themselves and goes through all the individual pictures and edits them and color equalizes and, you know, maybe paints out clouds or whatever it is, you're gonna have clouds. You can see some areas there are clouds, and those clouds will end up being right on the ground following the terrain, so it looks a little jarring, but it works. It's a quick and dirty way to really ratchet up the realistic look of the places you're going and the interest level. I'll tell you, I'll have to make a video of Australia because I went over
the cabin is secure.
The outback, and it's just amazing.
Flight attendants.
All right, we're at 2500. We need to really focus here now, make sure everything's set. Now that buzzing is telling us we need to put down the landing gear. I'm not sure why I'm taking so long to put down the landing gear. If you can figure it out, I'm making this commentary after the fact. We're gonna go down to 160 knots. Get down to flaps 25. And here you can see some of those clouds right on the surface of the ground from the ortho photo. We're eventually going to want to get down to our landing speed plus 5 knots. And you can see the glide slope has been captured, those two pink diamonds. It will follow that in, and if we decide to turn off the autopilot, all we have to do is follow those two big diamonds. Well, there we go. Get the landing gear down. You can see those clouds. They don't look too terrible depending on where you are. Maybe some low fog. I think that's the Air Force base off to the
1,000 feet stable
off on the horizon. Alright, we want to descend to 2100. No, 2500. Yep. And everything is set there. Now I actually don't have to hit that button. That Zeebo comes with announcements, but if you're using SimBuddy, those same announcements are already happening. So I got it kind of doubling up right now. All right, we're lined up, we're looking good. The glide slope is taking us in. We are at flaps 30. I think that is what we are going with. Again, I'm making this after the fact. And we're gonna disengage the autopilot, and we're gonna take this in ourselves. So now we gotta control the throttle. If we drop out the throttle too quick, we will just thump right onto the ground. It'll be a nice hard landing. Well, let's try to get this smooth. So we're at the minimums, and we are coming down for landing. We're a little bit low. And closer to diamonds, up a little bit high now.
200.
Kind of want to be even on the glide slope, and we're a little bit high. Okay, we're coming a little fast.
50, 40.
And we're gonna pull 30, back on the throttle 20, and flare. 10. And we landed. I don't hear any clapping from the passengers, so it was a little bit of a solid landing. We're down to 80 knots. Once we get down to 45, we'll turn off the reversers. And we will pull off right here at, let's see, let's pull up the airport plan. I believe we're going to be pulling off at Echo? I think that was Echo. It's either Echo or Golf. I didn't see the sign. Flipped off all the, flipped the lights to where they need to be, flipped off the TCAS. We're gonna have to retract those speed brakes. There we go, and we'll start bringing back the flaps. And we're gonna taxi into position along Kilo. I think this is, yeah, this is gonna be Echo, and then we're gonna go Kilo, and then we're gonna find a gate, since we don't have ATC giving us an assignment. Alright, we'll pull into this gate here. It doesn't look like they have auto gate at this airport. I think this is just an airport that came with X-Plane.
Somebody is connected.
And there you go, you got a little Simbuddy bouncing off and on. I'll leave that in just to show you how annoying that can get. We're gonna pull in here. Now, if we download some other airports from some more custom airports with custom stuff, there will be auto gates where the gate will actually move and connect to your plane so that people can get off. There'll be air marshals or marshallers which will lead you in, or there'll be the auto gate feature that will, the little sign that will lead you right into your parking spot. So we're gonna bring the engines down. We'll let the flight attendants get back to duties.
Flight attendants,
they're gonna prepare the doors, open the doors, and we'll let the passengers start getting their bags. And thanks for coming along on this flight. I know it's long. This is a new thing that I'm going to be doing, and it looks like it worked pretty well. Again, little caveat here, this whole episode I didn't record any audio, and going forward I might not record audio. I might just have the stream of the flight, but if I can, I will record audio, let you know what I'm doing. I will try to make a step-by-step what I'm doing here, flipping all the switches live, so that it actually lines up and everything, and I can go at a pace that I'm doing it.
Captain,
please like the video, share it with your friends, share it with your friends and family, anyone who's interested in flying. Subscribe to the channel, and please comment below. Let me know what you like about it. Let me know if you want me to cut it up and just make it a smaller video, maybe just show the takeoff, landing, maybe a little bit of the cruise, some outside shots. Let me know what you want to see. But I kind of think that I almost want to keep it the full length, because then you can jump anywhere. I'll try to put links to important parts of the video, where here's the landing, here's the takeoff, here's the middle of the cruise or something, here's an interesting thing I saw. Because with some of these flights, we're going to be going over some nice ortho photos, especially when we get to America or Australia, New Zealand. There's a lot of cool stuff to see, and I don't want to just show you just little tiny things. It's almost the same as American Truck Simulator, where I just speed it up, and maybe that's what I'll do. I'll just speed it up and you can see the things, but it'll just be flying by 1,000% speed. So, alright, and here we got to look at all the places I've flown to so far in X-Plane. And basically everything since New Zealand is this new situation. So now, or this new world tour that I'm trying to do to get to every country. So we start with New Zealand, and here we are now in Guam. Until next time, this is X-Plane 11. I'm Martin Wenzel. Take care. Happy flying.